Do you, have you thought about, or do you have anything to say about the case of Bradley Manning? Where would he fit?
I mean, he fucked the authority. Can't all agree with me. Unless it's a highly self-selective crowd. Jim.
Amalia, I'd like to just go in another direction for a moment. You know, you have your anthology out now of your writing, but the book that I have to tell you is my favorite book by you is a book called Cures, which is a very sad book, but I think it really shows, represents what, how someone as privileged as you were, as smart as you were, as handsome as you were. That was very much set up, Marty. You know, that how the closet and coming out, and I would posit that Bradley Manning is who he is because he came out at 15 in a small Midwest town, and what that action does to an individual. But how you got from that place of deep self-loathing, being the person that you were, the kind of privileged and brains that you had, to today, and is there a parallel, do you think, experience even today where that kind of internalized homophobia still exists but manifests itself in a different way?
Yeah, the point I pick up on, I don't know if my central is.
to say, I can't believe you're 83, you look fantastic.
That's important.
I
the hell with residue, right?
Residue and all. I like your analysis of the gay movement, queer movement, where it is, where it's going. And what I wanted to gauge you about is sort of the conflicting emotions I have about marriage equality, which has become the preeminent, you know, issue for the establishment of the gay movement. On the one hand, you know, there are people that need the legal protections of civil marriage, and if they want to do that, that's great. You know, on the other hand, of course, there's the, you know, kind of, as someone who ascribes to the more liberationist, you know, radical ideas of how people relate to each other and sexual liberation, that you know, I feel like it's back, we're going backwards by trying to enter into this existing structure. But at the same time, in a way, I'm thinking by, you know, queer people entering civil marriage, we're going to change that institution. The ways, especially gay men, that they relate to each other in long-term relationships is very different than the way heterosexuals do. In terms of monogamy, in terms of the equality of the relationship, and you know, when straight people say that, you know, allowing gay people to get married is going to ruin the institution of marriage, I was like, yeah. That's a good thing about it. But I wanted to get your take on that.
I'm not clear. My take on what?
What I just said. that gay people, you know, marrying is going to change the institution of marriage for the better, as a different kind of institution. More.
Well, I don't see why.
Images of what's going on in Brazil. There's like a million people out in the streets as a reaction to the bus fare. And then in Turkey, there was like, you know, what happened. And it just feels like the Occupy movement, it goes through waves in the United States, but now what's going on in other countries seems to be like very interesting to me. So when I was looking at those pictures, you know, there was a lot of gay flags in those images coming out of Brazil. And I'm just curious, like how those, and maybe the conditions in these different places and how that affects the youth involvement. Because I do think it's, different in different places, and I'm just not sure why. You know,
you think the water's different?
The way that you relate to the culture in a way, like I feel like people maybe become alienated to a sense of having like a voice in certain times. Like, I don't know. It just seems like in when I see the images or read the articles about what's going on in Brazil and what's going on in Turkey, it seems like there's more of an ownership of their voice, like the youth voice, whereas I think it wanes and waxes, or maybe that's just because I'm closer to here. I live here, so maybe it's personal. I can't tell. But do you think that those movements, the Occupy movement, like, is very different in Brazil, what's going on? Because I don't know what's going on myself. Like, do you think Occupy movement in the United States is very, has different qualities as it would in other countries? And do you think, like, where it's going? Because it seems like right now there's much more activism in other countries than here, right now, today. A million people.
I think the
But from what I've read just today, it is, in the same way, not about one issue. It's about a structural issue, it's a reaction to that structure. And especially in Turkey, that's true, because the structure is, it's different. In Turkey, they're trying to take away the public park and change it. And I mean, there is so much corruption, and that's a really complicated story that I don't have the full picture to, but it does seem like in those places, the youth have more of a sense of wanting to overturn the system, whereas I think here we get siphoned off into different categories more, it seems like what you're saying, like we have people who are concerned with these small issues and they're not rallying together in the same way, except with the exception of what happened with the Occupy movement.
Yeah.
That seemed fleeting in a sense.
Well,
and I'd say, as long as Kathy Cohen is writing and working, and Marty Duberman is quoting her and telling me, I have some hope. And I wanted to, your own work on race and liberation, historically, as a scholar in activism, is inspiring. And to think some about that, so our movement is right to call on John Lewis to stand up, and he does, but we don't. Currently in the leadership organizations then say, thanks a lot, how can we help you, right? So there's not reciprocity. And we may have a moment next week where the Supreme Court goes one direction on affirmative action and potentially the other, the direction of more liberation on marriage. what are your thoughts on how we get, you know, sort of more of the Kathy Cohen, Marty Duberman spark going in the movement on the street and try and rebuild a sense that freedom is something, our freedom has been won, thanks to the struggles of others, and will move forward by forging those alliances. So what do you see in history or currently to rebuild and renew that part of the movement in terms of making alliances, particularly as it relates to African-American and other racial liberation?
I think I've already
That's with no disrespect at all from what you're saying, because I agree, as you know, with every single word that you've spoken tonight. But you know, the part where in Turkey where this broke out was a gay cruising party. And some of the first people to be visible in those demonstrations were rainbow flag bearing people. Yet we did not see any of that in any of our media. And I can send you pictures that shows those rainbow flags, the rainbow flags that a lot of the white, academically trained, post-gay people put down, are very, very important to people around the world. You look what happens in Eastern Europe, those brave people who stand up to not just the homophobic Nazis, but to the cops that are beating them up, to the elected officials that are beating them up. The spirit of gay liberation that comes out of a period in our lifetime has really infected, in a deep way, all over the world, and just because here at home, I will not even cede the gay movement to those that have seized it, mm-hmm. because there's a lot of poor people, people of color, of gender non-conforming groups, the groupings, that when you go and young, and when you go and you sit with them, and you know, you don't talk too much to them, you just sit with them, you'll find out that the seeds of radicalism are there because of their life experiences. So I am much more hopeful. And the Bradley Mannings of the world set a powerful, you know, at first, none of the gay organizations have come out in favor of Bradley Manning, but a lot of the Bradley Manning supporters did not want to admit that he was a young gay man who has some gender questions, like I hope would hope that every young person has some gender questions because of the way they're imposed on all of us. So I'm more hopeful about this. And what's going to happen on Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, or Thursday when that Supreme Court comes down? And I have no belief that it's going to give us everything we want. And how they divide up what we can get and what they're unwilling to get, and how young people are going to respond to that. Whether I think gay marriage or same-sex civil marriage is a radical issue or not is not important. It radicalized a lot of young people who thought that they were post-gay, and they suddenly discovered that their being queer meant that they were seen as that which they did not want to be, was gay or lesbian. And in this space, you come down here anytime, you'll hear these young poets, these young writers, these young performance people, they have a radical look at the world, which makes me so happy that it didn't all die with AIDS, you know? So I think that there is a, and just look at this wall, you know, just look at this stuff, you know, that, you know, a lot of it is about body. But God knows that the gay movement for a long time avoided body, you know, avoided talking about sex, avoided talking about those things. So I'm realistic, you know, and I'm old too. But I do feel that we have done a good job, our generations, in seeding and keeping alive as best we can by watering these little plants, these little sprouts, and they're all in this fucking wall.
Yeah, and it's sort of it hasn't cohered my question, but it's even after all this time of thinking, especially after all this time of thinking. I'm 55, which places me somewhere in the middle of everything. And when I came up, I was sort of educated, sort of underground by lesbian feminists and gay consciousness raising and all that kind of stuff. And I always was surprised when I was a pre-teenager and teenager to find out that gay folks weren't smarter than everyone else and more artistic than everybody else and more political and totally left. And it shocked and horrified me. I mean, I once had a fight with David Bowie about it on the radio on WBAI. One of my points is that I think that there always has been such a large percentage of the gay population who before may not have been out and now may or may not be out, but still are of a social class and environmental situation where they wouldn't be exposed to anything that would be any kind of left thinking. I mean, if I didn't grow up in New York, I don't know if I'd be the same kind of thinker that I am. And so I'm not really sure where things are going. But I had been very disappointed by the gay movement turning toward marriage as the sole focus. But I also think somehow that came out of AIDS, which became a way that queerness became something that was, that people had to deal with one way or the other, like it or not, and because it's so close, and people who never would have come out came out by default. And then people started realizing the people in their families that they knew but never talked about, and so on. Anyway.
But how does that lead to marriage?
Because I think the general population, which has always been more conservative, is looking for those conservative values, and they haven't been radicalized.
Yeah, makes sense.
Thank you very much for coming. Feel free to share the sign. We have a book for sale. It's up to you sign.
Right, the bookstore is not. It is not the best.
Thanks for bringing the
door. Thank you.
So this is what we were working on. It's like a bus poster.
Great thoughts. Thank you for that.
What the hell I said.